Good evening, folks. It's lovely to have you with me again to this evening. I'm delighted if you can join me, it'd be great. As we journey on through Mark this evening, I pray that you're all well and that everyone is keeping their spirits up and enjoying life to the full. And I pray that this evening that the words that God will speak to you will resonate with you. Before we start our evening worship together, let's just pray. So let's just take a moment to close our eyes and reflect on God as we listen to the words of a song by an artist called Amy Grant, and the song is called "Thy Word is a Lamp unto My Feet."
A lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the
Our Bible reading this evening comes from Mark chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. Jesus withdrew his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard all that he was doing, many people came from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him to keep those people from crowding him, for he had healed many, so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him. Whenever the evil spirits saw him, They fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God." But he gave them strict orders not to tell who he was. So folks, we continue this evening our journey through Mark, which Oliver very kindly started for us a couple of weeks ago with an introduction into who Jesus is in the beginning. Who was Jesus? And last week, Angela looked a little bit about the beginning of Jesus' ministry and how Jesus' words started and deeds started to fill people full of wonder and awe, and the work that he was doing started to make people sit up and take notice. This week, what I would like to do is move a little further on in Jesus' ministry and take a little look at his words and his deeds, mainly focusing on the words that he said, how they impacted people then and how they can impact us still today, how Jesus used the words in his ministry to get a point across to people, to bring people closer to God. Do you ever meet anybody in your life who has the gift of the gab? Now, I know I like to talk, but that's not what I mean. Sometimes people have a little bit of trouble shutting me up, but no, that's definitely not what I mean. Do you ever meet someone who is so good at telling a story that everybody just sits and listens? They don't speak, they don't interrupt, they laugh where they're supposed to, and they listen to the very end. And whenever you go away and you retell that story, you can never ever get it just as well as the person who originally told it. We have a family friend like that. And on occasions whenever we've had trouble or whatever in the family, especially when my father passed away, he came to the house and he told us story after story, most of which was true, about the rough day that he'd had this past couple of days or whatever, and had us in stitches. At a time when we were mourning, at a time when we were sad, he made us laugh. He brought laughter into the sadness through his words. The words had an impact on us as a family. And whenever you ask him about it, he will always say to you, "But that's my job. My job is to be there and make people laugh when they need me the most." And that's a little bit like Jesus. This Jesus who came to minister to the people, to bring God's news to the people. Oliver touched a little bit about in the beginning. Who is this Jesus? Where did he come from? And he talked about how Jesus uses ordinary people, everyday people, to do his work. In the case of John, an ordinary everyday man who was tasked with proclaiming the birth of Christ and the coming of the new Messiah. Angela last week touched a little bit on the beginnings of Jesus' ministry and how his work started to fill people with wonder and awe, and how the work that God had given him to do started to resonate with people, and people wanted to know that a little bit more. This week, I'm going to be delving a little bit deeper into Jesus' ministry, mainly focusing on his words and his stories and how he used these to get the message of the gospel across to people. Jesus was a little bit like the friend of our family. I don't know whether he made people laugh all the time or whether he had them rolling around belly laughing or not. Maybe he did. We'll never know. But he had a way with words that made people listen and sit up and take notice. Not everybody took notice straight away, but gradually, the more Jesus spoke, the more Jesus did, the more people sat up and began to take notice. And what he had to say was important. What he had to say was for everyone, not just for the Pharisees, not just for the priests and the teachers of the law. They were for everybody. None more so, I think, than his disciples. Jesus had that much to say to people that he needed, even he needed a little bit of help. He needed somebody there to carry that message on, to get it out there to more people than maybe he felt he could. And that's when he calls his disciples. People, everyday, ordinary people with a specific skill set. We had fishermen, we had tax collectors. People who weren't afraid to talk to people. People who weren't afraid to say how they felt, what they thought, what they were thinking. I don't think I've ever met a tax collector who has a sense of humor, let's put it that way. But Jesus knew that these men had a purpose. Now, I'd love to have been there whenever he did speak to them and he said to them, you know, come and follow me. I'd love to know how he said it. So that it just like that, it made them turn and leave everything, drop everything and follow him. Because in their hearts, they must have known that something amazing was happening or was going to happen if they followed this man, Jesus. When you think about it, Jesus calling disciples is a little bit like us in his ministry today. The disciples were comfortable in their lives. Maybe they had good jobs. They were enjoying their work. They were maybe making good money. And Jesus called them away from all of that by saying, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. His words had an impact on them. They wanted to find out more about his ministry and wanted to be involved in his ministry. And a bit like us today, how many of us are so stuck in our comfort zone in church, in our own Christian lives, that we just do the same humdrum thing every day, and we enjoy doing the same humdrum thing every day. But sometimes we just need that spark to change it up a little bit, to mix it up a little bit, to remind us that Jesus has a purpose for us, that he wants us out there talking to people, spreading the gospel to people. I'd like to read a little bit from the book that we've been studying by Donald English, and it's called The Message of Mark. And this particular passage is about Jesus calling the apostles, apostleship and discipleship. So I'm just going to read a little bit of that to you now. The balance is not easy to keep in lively tension. Many Christians seem to spend so much more time just being with Jesus and much less in proclaiming and casting out demons. Much training for ordination also seems to concentrate on the pastoral concerns of caring for the church community. All of that is necessary, but if it's dominant, it provides a largely inward-looking perspective to church life. We are much more vulnerable and at risk, and there, for that very reason, we can prove the extent and power of the message we proclaim and the authority it carries. If we hold back from the risk, we shall never discover how great and how many-sided the gospel is. Here, Jesus calls his disciples fishers of men. He wanted them out there. He wanted them doing things that he knew they could do. Saying things to people, speaking to people. We see this on Pentecost when the tongues of fire touched their heads and the disciples were able to speak in so many different tongues. Languages they had never imagined they could speak in. And they were able to talk to so many different people and spread the gospel of Jesus and God to everyone in the world. How phenomenal is that? That they were able to do this? It's such a gift and such a wonder. The gift of speech, the gift of words. The gift to be able to go out and talk to people. Now, I've said this before. to quite a few number of people that preaching was never something that I ever dreamed that I would ever do. Spreading the gospel of God is something I've always done, not in private, but in one-to-one conversations or small groups or as a youth pastor, but never in front of a big congregation and never certainly online. But God has a funny way of using his words to get a message across. He puts them inside us, and at some point they have to get out. And just like in his ministry, Jesus had so much he could talk about with the disciples and with the teachers and the priests and the people in the synagogues, but he also had so much more to say to everyone else as well. Jesus himself took risks. He challenged the disciples. He challenged the Pharisees. He challenged the teachers of the law. He even challenged his own family to stop and think about what the real message of truth and the real message of the gospel is. The thing I love and cherish a lot about Jesus is his truthfulness and his honesty. And sometimes he can be quite brutal in his honesty, but most of the time it's needed. We need to hear what he has to say in order to be able to take action, to go and do something about it. If we delve a little further into Mark, we see that in chapter 3 from verse 20 onwards, Jesus starts using parables to make his point. And we all know the saying that it's a wise saying or story with a heavenly meaning. That's what I grew up knowing and learning. But if we really take a look at the parables and read them in depth and study them, the meaning is so much more than that Sunday school story you were taught growing up, or what you taught the children in Sunday school that you had in your class. He didn't use these parables to confound people or to riddle me this or riddle me that, to make them really confused about things, but he used them to explain things more clearly. Jesus knew throughout his ministry he wouldn't be talking to scholars, he would be talking to ordinary everyday people who needed ordinary everyday language. And a lot of the time these parables had meanings which astounded and evoked emotions in people they never thought possible. Sometimes they had a positive effect, sometimes they had a negative effect. Sometimes they made people think about things that they didn't ordinarily realize they needed to think about. But no matter how positive or how negative these stories were taken, they always had a truth, they always had a sincerity, they always had a meaning behind them. Jesus always had the same message about the kingdom of heaven. And he always had the same message about how much God loves us and how much we need to be children of God and what we need to do to find that and to be the person that God calls us to be today. So what does this mean for us? Let's have a little bit, another read and another passage from Donald's book. Reading from Mark chapter 3 verse 20 onwards, it says that the movement of the kingdom is gathering momentum of its own. More and more people are playing their part, and the disciples themselves must have certainly felt an increasing danger of things getting out of hand. They've come a long way since those early thrilling days when they were first called. Did Jesus feel this too? There is an excitement about being launched out into deep and choppy waters in God's service, But sadly, so many churches and Christians miss it by playing safe. As his ministry grew and Jesus' word snowballed and his message grew, Jesus fills us with excitement, filled the people with excitement. The disciples felt the desire to get out there and do what Jesus was asking them to do. And for us, this excitement comes from playing our part in Jesus' continuing ministry. It didn't stop. It has never stopped. His words are still there, written on pages for us to carry forward. So let me issue you with a challenge first. What will we do? What will you do? How will we share this gospel? How will you continue using God's words effectively to spread his gospel message? So many of us miss out on the glorious results of being a disciple of God by playing it safe and only saying what we expect people to hear. As I said earlier, the disciples were people who weren't afraid to say what they felt and weren't afraid sometimes to say how they saw things. Could you be like the disciples? Could we be like the disciples? Could we be bold, getting out into the world, spreading this good news, sharing the gospel? Think of the impact those words can have on people. Think of the message God has to say through us. Do you want to miss out on it? I know I don't. Jesus' ministry is gathering momentum. The kingdom is gathering momentum and it's heading towards the climax of all climaxes. And as I read on more and more, I get more excited by the possibilities that Mark opens up through Jesus' ministry. What I would encourage you all to do is to go back and read Mark, the Gospel of Mark, yourselves. Delve in that little bit deeper. Find out who this Jesus is, where his ministry is going. His ministry is gathering momentum and taking us along with it. So please, I would urge you, read the book of Mark. If you want to, certainly get a copy of this book, The Message of Mark, and read along with the book. And it will open your eyes to a whole new ministry and a whole new way of looking at Jesus. So will you decide to play it safe? Or will you decide to let your words speak for themselves? Amen. Let's come together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we think of those who need your words right now. We thank you, Lord, for your ministry to those people. We thank you, Lord, that your words have such an impact on us here in the world today. And we thank you that we are able to spread those words to those who need it. Especially at this scary time, Lord, when the pandemic is again rearing its ugly head. And we're scared. We're worried about what's going to happen, about what is happening, about the people that we love. Father, we need your words of comfort now. Share with us your ministry of hope, your ministry of healing. Share with us your words of grace, of love. Bring us your joy, your laughter, in a time where there is despair. Father, we pray for those who are grieving right now. We pray, God, that you would come and be with them. Surround them with your arms. Give them a massive big hug, God. Let them know you're there and that everything is going to be okay. We pray for those in our congregation who are ill and in need of your tender healing touch. Lord, bring your words and bring your healing to them. We pray for a struggling world. We have a government who have to make difficult decisions every day. And we pray, God, for wisdom, for mercy, and for right decisions to be made. And we pray for generosity among the people as well, generosity of spirit, that we will try our best to support those making the decisions and not tear them down at every opportunity because it doesn't suit us or we don't like what they have to say. Father, you place people in positions for a reason. And we pray that they would use the gift that you have given them for you and for your glory. Father, in this world where there is war, where there is conflict, where there is persecution every day, we pray for peace. We pray that your words of love will touch the hearts of many. That your grace will show itself in all its glory. And Lord, that people will know that you are a God of peace and reconciliation. Thank you, God, that we can come to you in prayer, that you listen to every word that comes from our mouths and our hearts. And we pray, God, that these prayers will be offered up to you and that you, Lord, will answer them in your time. With words that flow from your mouth and bring us peace. For it's in your name I pray. Amen. Well, folks, that brings us to the end of another Sunday evening of worship. I pray that you have heard God's voice this evening and that what he has to say will resonate with you. So take care. Thank you for joining me this evening and for listening to some of my short ramblings. I pray that you'll keep well and that you'll take care of each other. Keep washing your hands and keep looking out for each other. Keep singing. Keep laughing. And let's spread joy in a hard time. God bless. Take care. Good night.
Everything.
have searched me, and you know me. You know everything I do. Lord, you have searched me, and you know me. You know everything I do. So I give my life to you. Bring my heart and mind to you. Lord, I come to
investigate my life, O God. Find out everything about me. Cross-examine me and test me. Get a clear picture of what I'm about. See for yourself whether I've done anything wrong. Then guide me on the road to eternal life.
So I give my life to you. Bring my heart and mind to you. Lord, I come to worship you.